Sir, we are live, sir.
Sir, we are live now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Every morning starts a new page in your story. Make it a great one today. I, Subhash Srinithi, from Chennai Institute of Technology, third year civil engineering. It's a great pleasure and honor to welcome you all for this faculty development program on sustainable smart cities. May I now invite the principal, Dr. P. Parthiban, to deliver the welcome address. Welcome you, sir.
Very good morning, everyone.
So, sir, your voice is not audible. Closer to the mic.
Yes, sir. Yes. Very good morning to everyone, respected chairman, loved chief guest, my dear participants. It is our great pleasure to have you all here for the Knowledge Boosting Zero webinar series, which is one of the unique initiatives of Chennai Institute of Technology under the guidance of our honorable chairman, C.P. Srilam. A successful first generation entrepreneur, a well-known industrialist and managing director of Engg group of companies. Under Knowledge 4.0 series, we have been conducting webinar series such as technical webinar series, research webinar series, career guidance webinar and innovation webinar series. Today we have the second day of the OTP on sustainable smart cities. We have Dr.E.Natarajan, Dean College of Engineering, Chennai University, who is going to talk about green energy management. I welcome you to this wonderful forum. Chennai Institute of Technology was established in the year 2010 by our honorable chairman, B. Srilam. Now our institute is being ranked within top 10 institutes among private engineering colleges in Tamil Nadu. It is my great pleasure to welcome our honorable chairman and thank you for this constant motivation and support. I would like to mention one point about our chief guest and the today's speaker. He has done a lot of initiative in the energy area and he has also helped given an encouragement to our to start a new project called Green Bricks. So we have started a green brick manufacturing and there is a startup in our institute. So it is going to be functioned soon. So for this, I thank Dr. Natarajan sir. So once again, welcome you all for this.
Thank you. You can start, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Now our chief guest, Dr. E. Natarajan, from the College of Engineering, Guindy. He secured his bachelor degree in mechanical engineering in the year 1990. He done his master's in thermodynamics, combustion and propulsion, and he also obtained his doctorate in renewable energy in the year 1998. Years of teaching and research experience in the field of thermal and energy engineering and successfully guided many doctoral research candidates.
He has
published many peer-reviewed articles in journals and conferences and made large number of presentations. He is mentioned to be a fellow of Indian Society for Technical is involved in the installation and performance testing of a pilot plant for solar drying of lignite at the Center for Applied Research and Development in NLC India. He is also officiating as the director of Institute for Energy Studies and coordinator of an university NLCIL Innovation Hub for Energy Sustainability. And now he is currently dean at College of Engineering, Guindy. Now I request Dr. E. Natarajan to deliver his inaugural address along with the session on green energy management. Welcome you, sir.
Good your mic, switch on the mic, sir. Unmute mic.
Is it audible now?
Yes, sir.
Good morning to everyone. It is a pleasure to be here to deliver a special lecture on green energy management. Talk on energy is the need of the day. We have been using energy right from the day of our inception. Energy is a vital force for our industrial growth. The use of energy has been increasing day by day and year by year. But the growth in energy consumption in the recent past is extremely high. Thereby, it leads to two important consequences. Number one, it puts a lot of stress on existing energy resources. Let me share the screen as well. The pattern in which we have been using energy is putting a lot of stress on the existing energy resources. The way we use energy also leads to the other consequences like environmental impact. Thereby, our intention is to implement green energies and manage this use of green energy for the better future. This short presentation is going to focus on the major options available for our green energy applications and kind of management that we can do for our day-to-day uses. Any energy derived from natural resources such as sunlight, wind, water, tides, plants, algae, and geothermal heat are considered to be green energy. In fact, all green energy resources are renewable in nature and they are naturally replenished. If you look at some of the examples for green energy applications, they include biomass, solar energy, wind energy, hydel energy, tidal energy, geothermal energy, and compressed natural gas, and energy similar to this. All these energy sources are much known to all of us, and we have been using them in earlier days. Over a period of time, to overcome some inconveniences associated with these energies, we have switched over to fossil fuels. Fossil fuels are a bit convenient to use, however, they all lead to enormous environmental pollution. The way fossil fuels are taken from earth and the way they are processed are extremely costly. Not only that, they are extremely dangerous to environmental issues. Hence, it insists upon the need for us to go back to the use of green energy sources with which we started in the beginning. These are some of the reasons that we have to resort ourselves to the use of green energy resources. Always, green energy resources are reliable sources of energy. In fact, when we use green energy, we have to plan the different green energies available in different seasons as well as in different periods, and hence we can ensure fuel diversification. The use of green energy can lead to enhanced energy security. Since most of the energy resources associated with green energy are locally available, and hence we can lower the risk of fuel shortage, and we don't have to depend on the other countries from where the fossil fuels are mostly imported. Hence, it also leads to reduced need for imported fuels. We have to pay enough attention to conserve our natural resources in such a way that the need for the current technology through green energy is ensured. Hence, it becomes a sustainable mechanism to make sure that the green energy resources are sustained, maintained, and used for the purpose of future technologies. Among all the green energy resources, biomass is considered to be most promising, readily available, and distributed all over the earth, so that it deserves our first attention. In the development of green energy technologies also, the development of technologies for utilization of biomass took a lead. Even during Second World War, there were a number of systems which were developed for the purpose of converting biomass into usable energies, particularly biomass gasifiers for the purpose of automobile propulsion. Then, many large-scale power plants have been installed to convert biomass into usable energy in terms of generating combustible gas or liquid fuel or even direct energy generation through electrical generators. Any material derived from photosynthesis is considered to be a biomass. In fact, biomass is another form of solar energy. We all know no photosynthesis could happen in the absence of sunlight. And hence, biomass is basically another refined form of solar energy. Example for biomass include wood, branches, leaves, forest residues, agricultural residues. Biomass is basically a renewable fuel. The plant matter is generated in the presence of sunlight with the help of carbon dioxide, water vapor, water, and the chlorophyll. The different biomass, what is available in the nature, is probably it could be either wooden bars or wood pieces themselves or wood powders and wood shavings coming out of furniture industry or wood processing industry or agricultural residues like rice straw, briquetted fuels or powdery fuels, something like rices, groundnut shell, etc. All these materials can be conveniently converted into usable fuel. Hence, they are all natural sources of energy and they are all widely available all over the world. Particularly, the countries which are using agriculture as major profession is the one which can use large amount of biomass for their own sustenance. The sustainable use of biomass is well established over many decades. The carbon dioxide generated by the use of biomass material can be cleared by another set of trees, and hence continuous cyclic plantation of trees will lead to a sustainable world. The use of biomass will ensure that there is no net pollution, and hence it can lead to a sustainable future. So the management of biomass fuel utilization as well as corresponding biomass fuel generation used to be done very judiciously in such a way that there is no imbalance. If this management is done basically, then ensuring our energy supply would never be a deal. Without doing any deforestation, the wasteland available in different parts of the country can be put to better use in such a way enough amount of biomass is generated for feeding the power plants. The energy generated from biomass could be used for all different applications, what is being done with the help of fossil fuels. In fact, when the fuel is used and it is mixed with air and burned to release energy, the quantity of energy released by unit quantity of fuel is said to be an heating value. There are two types of heating value, known as higher heating value and lower heating value. When the fuel is burned, the maximum possible heat that can be derived from burning a fuel of unit quantity is said to be an higher heating value. We all know basically fuels are hydrocarbons. When carbon is burned, it becomes carbon dioxide. It is an exothermic reaction. It also releases heat. When hydrogen is burned, it is also exothermic reaction. It further releases heat. However, hydrogen on burning with oxygen produces only water. Water cannot remain as liquid in the high combustion atmosphere. Hence, it evaporates into vapor. The heat required for converting liquid water into vapor hydrogen, vapor form of water is also taken from the same atmosphere. Thereby, part of heat released during combustion is utilized for converting liquid water into vapor. And hence, part of the heat is lost. So, the amount of heat lost for converting liquid H2O into vapor H2O is not available for effective use. So, if you subtract that heat, the remaining heat available is said to be lower heating value. Hence, let's understand only the lower heating value is effectively available for our applications. When we use biomass, we get a lower heating value of around 12 megajoule per kg. When we use hydrocarbon fuels like petrol and diesel, we get about 44 megajoule per kg of fuel. So this is a big limitation with biomass fuels. It all informs that we need relatively large quantity of fuel for getting same amount of energy. That is a major inconvenience to be bad with. However, it is most environmentally friendly. In long time, this can lead to convenient, sustainable development. So this higher heating value is also said to be higher calorific value or gross heating value or gross calorific value. It shows the potential of the fuel to produce energy per unit quantity. The net heat available for day-to-day application is indicated by lower heating value, also known as lower calorific value, net heating value or net calorific value. Biomass is basically an hydrocarbon material. This hydrocarbon material can be conveniently converted into usable energy through two simple routes. One is said to be direct combustion. The other one is gasification. During direct combustion, sufficient quantity of oxidation material, oxidation medium, is introduced with biomass. Thereby, it is completely burned and converted into usable products, meaning hot gases. These hot gases can be used in furnaces, kilns, or steam generator. The steam generator will convert liquid fuel into vapor. This vapor can be used for driving mechanical machines to produce shaft power. This biomass material can be converted into a combustible gas through gasification. This gas can also be used in internal combustion engines in such a way that it can lead to generation of shaft power. Thereby, these two popular routes are mainly used for converting biomass energy into usable energy. The technologies which is required for direct conversion of biomass into usable energy and gasification into shaft power is readily available. In fact, combustion of fuel is the first technology understood by mankind. It took different transformation. Today, our understanding of combustion is highly beneficial for mankind, and major part of our electricity is generated through thermal power plants. Thermal power plants are capable of converting solid fuels or liquid fuels or gaseous fuels into thermal energy. This thermal energy later converted into mechanical energy, and then they are converted into electrical energy. So the present thermal power plants could as well be operated with biomass. The technologies are available. Probably they may require a bit of fine tuning for making it as convenient as fossil fuel based power plants. In fact, to elaborate upon the conversion process of these biomass materials, there are different routes, or wide routes are available for this. When the biomass is processed only with heat in the absence of any oxidizing medium, it is said to be pyrolysis. Pyrolysis can lead to generation of pyrolysis oil or medium energy gas. It can also produce char, which could be a fuel for different industry. This medium energy gas could be used in internal combustion engines to produce high grade shaft power. If biomass is operated or processed with the air and then gasified into combustible gas, we will get low energy gas. This low energy gas can be used for thermal applications. Let's understand, gasification is basically a partial combustion wherein we can convert solid fuel into combustible gases. Gasification of biomass with the help of oxygen can lead to generation of again medium energy gas. The efficiency of this system is far better than air gasification, and this medium energy gas is again useful for either shaft power generation or for any other thermal application as well. Instead of oxygen, hydrogen can also be used as a medium for gasifying this. After gasifying, this product gas can be used for medium energy gas applications. Gasification technology is meant for converting solid fuel into combustible gaseous fuel, and this gaseous fuel can be cleaned and cooled, and then it could be used in engine for producing high grade mechanical energy. Or if it is not possible to cool properly, it can be used for producing even thermal energy directly. Generally, the producer gas generated out of reactor of a gasifier could lead to a gas containing carbon monoxide of about 20%, methane of about 3%, hydrogen of about 20%, carbon dioxide of about 12%, and the remaining could be nitrogen. And this gas could be conveniently used for either thermal applications or shaft power applications. Depending upon the way the fuel and air comes in contact with each other in order to produce combustible gas, they are classified as downdraft gasifiers, updraft gasifiers, crossdraft gasifiers, or open core gasifiers. Each gasifier has a unique feature so that their application is limited. You could see in the case of downdraft gasifier, the fuel flows towards downside, that is from top to bottom, making use of or taking advantage of the gravity of the fuel into account. In fact, in all the cases, fuel flows from top to bottom to make use of the gravitational advantage, that is the gravity of the fuel or weight of the fuel is taken into advantage to move the fuel from top to bottom. As the fuel moves from top to bottom, solid fuel gets converted to gaseous fuel and ash descends down. The direction of flow of air decides what kind of gasifier it is. So in downdraft gasifier, air flows top to bottom as a co-current with fuel. In the case of updraft gasifier, air flows from bottom to top. In transdraft gasifier, it flows across. In fluidized bed gasifier or in an open core gasifier, there are, you know, the core becomes open. Not only that, you can use powdery fuel for processing that. Fuel and air flows as a co-current matter. In fact, in earlier days, it was thought that the biomass reactors could be used only for thermal applications such as drying, furnaces, operations of kiln, etc. Later, it has been proved that these gases can be conveniently cleaned and cooled and could be used in internal combustion engines for generating electricity. In later days, they are being used even in gas turbines. Thereby, we can think of applications with high energy requirements or high capacity applications. It is quite suitable for village electrification, for captive power generation, or grid linked power generation system. A fixed bed reactor based biomass system could contain three different sections as it is shown in the picture. There is a reactor which is capable of converting solid fuel into gaseous fuel. Then this gaseous fuel is fed into portion B, which is basically a furnace where it is mixed with oxidizer and burnt to produce thermal energy. This thermal energy can be effectively transferred to any liquid medium to convert that liquid medium into vapor. This vapor can be processed through Rankine cycle, where thermal energy can be converted into mechanical energy. These reactors are available now in widespread applications. You could see the gasifier where the biomass is converted to gaseous fuel, and this gaseous fuel can be used in engines. So we had a program with the Swedish government where there was a scientist from Sweden who was taken through different gasifier based power plants in India, and we made a study to understand the limitations, challenges of this technology so that we can identify solutions for them. So this is a reactor portion. So you can see the gasification taking place through this window. So this is a reactor in which solid fuel is converted into gaseous fuel. This gaseous fuel is collected on the top, and then they are all cleaned and processed and used for different applications. A gasifier gasifies the solid fuel into gaseous fuel by passing this solid fuel through different zones such as drying zone, distillation zone, reduction zone, and then finally combustion zone or arc zone. Here the fuel descends from top to bottom to get converted itself into a gaseous fuel. The air moves from bottom to top, being absorbed gasifier. The gas obtained from the gasifier, absorbed gasifier, is likely to have relatively higher heating value. This gasifier can tolerate moisture up to 20%. It's a multi-fuel system. It can operate with a variety of fuels. It can work either with briquettes, coal, wooden pieces, or even sometimes agricultural residues to limited extent. It has easy removal of ash, so it can take raw material which contains high ash material such as coal. The disadvantage of that gasifier is that the quality of gas is comparatively low, as it is having high tar and particulate matter, and hence it cannot be used for application in engines. However, it can be used for thermal applications. So if the biomass material is to be applied for thermal applications, then updraft gasifiers are quite suitable. In the case of downdraft gasifiers, the air also flows from top to bottom through the arc zone as it is shown here. Even here, the number of layers are similar. However, the arrangement of layers are slightly different. Because of this unique arrangement, it can lead to gases with better quality. Due to high quality gas, it is suitable for power applications. It is also suitable for thermal application where high quality gas is required, such as, you know, metallurgical applications. It can only undertake woody biomass, charcoal, and the material should have low ash content, having low moisture, and should not cripple under heat. If the fuel has high ash content, high moisture, this kind of reactors would not be suitable. However, this kind of gasifiers could be conveniently used for producing relatively clean gas suitable for engine applications. There are applications where there is frequent change in demands. If there is a change in demand often, that kind of applications could be met by crosstrap gasifiers. A good example for such application is automobiles. So we may require to accelerate quickly, decelerate sometime. In such cases, crosstrap gasifiers could lead to a better generation of gas as the demand changes accordingly. When biomass materials are powdery in nature, like rice husk, groundnut shell, or coffee husk and so on, one can go for fluidized gasifier. So depending upon the material, there are different reactors that are available. Hence, one has to understand what kind of fuels are available in the locality, and then try to manage those fuels with a suitable reactor to convert that into a usable energy form. These fluidized gasification system available in our laboratory, which can be operated with particulate type of biomass fuels like rice husk, groundnut shell, coffee husk, and so on. So this consists of three sections. One is a reactor section for converting biomass fuel into combustible gas. Then we have a cleaning section for processing that gas to be make it suitable for engine application. Then the application itself, there is an engine for using this gas. This diesel engine can operate with 70% of gas energy and 30% of diesel. Thereby, by using this kind of system, a considerable amount of diesel could be saved. But in the recent past, 100% gas engines are available, and hence the engine itself can operate with 100% gas generated from reactor. Now, there are large-scale power plants which are operated with biomass as fuel. There are power plants even with 300 to 600 megawatt operated with wood as fuel. This large-scale power plant are one of the best examples for sustainable development. Whenever large amount of biomass material available, like forest residues, agricultural residues, this kind of large power plants can be a solution for converting those materials into energy. So these power plants can have three different sections, one for processing the fuel and converting the fuel into combustible gas, another one for cleaning and processing the gas, and then finally converting that gas into usable energy. There are a number of systems operating in different parts of the world. The agricultural residues, which are generated in plenty and unable to process locally or unable to consume locally, could be processed through these power plants to convert them into electricity or thermal energy. So the large amount of rice husk or rice straw or other agricultural residues could be conveniently converted to usable form of energy instead of using a conventional electricity. So when there is shipbuilding industry or a large scale furniture making industry, the large quantity of wood shavings and wood powders delivered from the power plant can be a source of fuel for operating such power plants. When biomass power plants are used, there are certain limitations. The biomass price keeps changing from time to time depending upon the season and demand. Hence, it becomes a bit difficult to decide the economics of operation. And the lack of mechanization in most of agricultural countries in collecting this biomass and making it available for power plant operation is another important limitation. there are small handholdings are being used by farmers. Thereby, the collection mechanism becomes more complicated. If these limitations could be successfully overcome, then these biomass materials could be conveniently collected, processed, and used for power generation. This could be a viable mechanism for power generation and utilization. So, management of fuel collection and processing and ensuring continuous fuel supply for power plants can lead to a better operation of power plants for continuous power generation, and it can be a viable alternative for conventional power generating systems. The major advantage of biomass based power plants are that these kind of power plants are green energy power plants. There will not be any pollution. These kind of power plants are highly suitable for decentralized energy generation. There will be no need for centralized power generation and long distance distribution. This will be certainly a sustainable future energy source, independent energy source without any dependence on any other country. And another important source of energy is the solar energy. Needless to say, it is the first known energy for humankind to be used from the day of inception. It is a parent energy for all other energies as well. Solar-based energies could be classified into direct solar energy methods and indirect solar energy methods. Direct solar energy applications include thermal applications and photovoltaic applications. Indirect applications include hydropower applications, wind applications, ocean thermal energy applications, wave energy applications, tidal applications, and so on. Solar energy is prevalently available everywhere. However, the intensity of solar energy is less. When suitable systems are used, this energy can be collected conveniently and converted into a usable form of energy. Let's look at some of the solar thermal systems and management required for operating this system and applications of them and the present state of such systems. Solar thermal system basically consists of a solar collector for collecting solar energy, that is sunlight available from sun. Solar collector is basically a plate coated with selective absorption material so that photonic energy of sunlight can be absorbed and can be used for heating certain mediums such as air or water. Then this hot air or hot water can be used for thermal applications such as drying, cooking, or chemical processing, and so on. You could see a thermal collector for collecting solar energy. After absorbing this energy, this is transferred to a suitable working medium. The suitable working medium is used for an application meant for any specific industrial or domestic purpose. So the arrangements of components are shown here. You could see the solar thermal collector for receiving the solar energy. This thermic fluid or liquid or air, which is heated, is collected in a tank, and then this is used for any applications. Many enhancements or enough amount of research has gone into the material side as well as system side. A good amount of improvements have been made. Now the solar thermal collectors are commercially available. One can buy it off the shelf. There is no need for waiting for fabrication. The moment you decide the application, there are variety of systems available in the market for supply. Depending upon the capacity, depending upon the duration of application, various systems are available for thermal applications. This figure shows a popular solar water heating system known as flat plate collectors. Basically, there are flat plates coated with selective material embedded with liquid circulation system, in this case water circulation system. The water could be comfortably heated to about 65 to 85 degrees centigrade with the help of sunlight available. This water can be used for bathing, washing and sterilization purposes. When we go for evacuated tube based collectors, the temperature could be still high, as high as 120 degrees centigrade, and it could be more efficient also. However, the initial cost is likely to be a bit higher. So these kind of solar collectors are available in different shapes and sizes. It could be used for specifically thermal heating. In earlier days, it was thought that solar energy can be used only for generating hot water for bath. The improvements in the system led to the development of different equipments where high temperature working medium can also be generated. You can see the last column. Initially, the earlier day systems were capable of generating only 30 to 80 degree. Over a period of time, we could generate solar system that can generate even 2000 degree centigrade. Generally, solar thermal systems are classified into three types based on the way they are capturing sunlight: stationary systems, single axis tracking systems, two axis tracking systems. Stationary systems include flat plate collectors, evacuated tube collectors. Among them, you could see flat plate collectors can generate hot liquid at 30 to 80 degrees centigrade. Evacuated tube collectors can generate about 50 to 200 degrees centigrade. Single axis tracking system, like parabolic collectors, linear Fresnel reflector, parabolic trough collector, cylindrical trough collectors, these kind of collectors are capable of concentrating sunlight on the receiver, thereby they have higher effectiveness, indicated in terms of concentration ratio. You could see common parabolic collector as a concentration ratio in the order of 1 to 5, while the cylindrical trough collector has a concentration ratio in the order of 10 to 50. Thereby, there is a possibility that high temperature could be achieved, or rather we could say medium temperature can be achieved. So this kind of system is capable of delivering working fluid at a temperature of about 300 degrees centigrade. If you go for two-axis tracking systems, such as parabolic dish collector, heliostatic field collectors, then it can lead to high or very high temperatures, which is quite comparable with the present day systems. So these are the various applications from solar thermal energy. You can use this solar thermal energy for boiler feed water. You can use it for bathing laundry applications. You can use this for pasteurization, condensation, and cleaning in milk industry. You can use it for drying and tanning in leather industry, resin emulsification in polymer industry applications, applications related to degreasing and phosphating in metal industry. So it is not only meant for our domestic applications, they are highly suitable for industrial application as well. Countries like India is processing a good amount of agricultural products. And when there is an excess or surplus fruits and vegetables, they can be dried and be used for later applications. So one can go for solar drying applications. Solar drying is such a convenient process, it can dry large quantity of agricultural products at a rate which is required for drying application without destroying its nutritional value. A good amount of study being done all over the world to dry various agricultural products so that it can be preserved for a long while without losing their nutritional value or their basic properties. Even fruits could be sliced and dried properly and preserved for long time than what we expect. So a typical solar dryer looks like this. So there is a solar collector for collecting sunlight to create hot working fluid, basically a hot air. And there could be a dryer where this agricultural material or material to be dried could be loaded and dried conveniently. The major limitation with this kind of system is that it could be used only during daytime, but not during night time. In such case, one can go for thermal storage medium at the bottom, which can collect energy and store this energy during sunlight days so that it can be subsequently used for night drying also. So some thermal medium, whether a solid medium or a liquid medium, can be used for storing this energy so that this energy can be absorbed during night time and could be used for drying the material during off sunshine period. We can have different trays in which agricultural producers could be stored and then dried. Other than this, it can be used for large-scale industrial application also. This photograph shows a solar system designed for drying of lignite. You could see a solar field made up of evacuated tube collectors meant for direct heating of air. This hot air is generated. This hot air then taken through a rotary dryer through which lignite is passed. Lignite is mined from open cast mines. When it is taken from mines, it contains about 50% moisture. It cannot be directly fed into furnace because of high moisture. It has to be dried to about 15 to 20% of moisture before usage in furnace. Such lignites could be dried with the help of hot air generated from this kind of system. This evacuated tube collector is generating hot air at about 70 to 80 degrees centigrade. This air is used in a rotary dryer for drying the lignite into about 20% moisture, 15 to 20% moisture before being used in power plants. This is designed by Institute for Energy Studies for Renewables India Limited and installed at Center for Applied Research and Development for research purposes. In addition to this, we can think of integrated solution in such a way that maximum energy usage is possible in order to improve the overall efficiency of the system. This kind of cascaded green energy management system will lead to high efficiency and sustainable development. Let's look at one example. As you could see, there is a solar collector here for capturing solar energy and generating hot working fluid. This hot working fluid is passed through a storage medium so that the storage medium can contain enough amount of energy for even half sunshine period. We can have an air filter through which air can be passed and then this air will be heated so that we get a hot air during daytime. During daytime, this hot air can be generated with the help of solar collector themselves. During nighttime, this hot air can be generated by passing this air through a sensible storage system or a latent storage system. Thereby, we can continuously get air required for drying, whether it is day or night. Then, this hot air can be sent through rotary drum dryer through which lignite is passed for drying purposes. Air and lignite comes in contact with each other in counter current in order to have effective drying. Then dried lignite is received on the other side. then the lignite, dried lignite, can be mixed with suitable binder. Then it could be processed through briquetting machine so that it becomes solid material, easy for transport. The hot air that comes out of the dryer is still hot at about 110 degree. When it enters into rotary dryer, it's about 160 degree centigrade. When it comes out of it, it's about 110 degree centigrade. Instead of wasting this heat by sending this into atmosphere, it can be passed through a suitable system where it can operate vapor adsorption chiller. This vapor adsorption chiller is capable of producing cold energy, that is chill energy. This low temperature atmosphere created by adsorption system can be either used for space cooling applications or maintenance of greenhouse conditions, or this chilling effect can be used for cooling the air that comes out of the dryer in such a way that water vapor in the dryer exit air can be condensed. And hence, the water vapor collected by the drying air doesn't get wasted into atmosphere. The moisture in the exit air of dryer could be conveniently condensed and charged back into ground so that the groundwater is preserved. When the systems are cascaded like this, the overall efficiency improves. Not only that, the overall environmental effect is reduced. If we dry lignite with the help of hot air, the moisture is collected by the hot air and this moisture goes into atmosphere and water literally gets wasted. Instead, if this water can be conveniently captured and charged back into the ground, we can recover large quantity of water. We know very well, when 50% of moisture is there in the fuel, half of the fuel is liquid, that is water, and it gets otherwise wasted. It leads to large quantity of water loss. We know how precious water in the present days. Thereby, when such systems are proposed, we should always think in such a way that neither resources nor energy is wasted and their utilization should be put to optimum or maximum. In fact, let's look at this small video, short video, which shows the installation itself. So this part shows the solar collector, evacuated tube collectors. This is solar field with evacuated tube collectors capable of generating hot air at about 60 to 80 degrees centigrade. The only source of energy for this is sunlight. It doesn't require any fuel. It hardly requires any maintenance. Probably once in a week, we have to clean in such a way that the dust is not collected on the collector tubes. So the lignite is collected by conveyors. They are passed through a lignite crushing unit to crush them into uniform size. Then it is fed into a rotary dryer. Then the rotary dryer dries the material. The dried material is exiting the dryer, which can be used for suitable applications. This lignite drying system has been designed by Institute for Energy Studies for Center for Applied Research and Development of NLC India Limited, and we have suggested this for drying lignite. When we use only evacuated tube collectors, the hot air generated is limited to about 80 degrees centigrade, thereby the rate of drying is very slow. In order to increase the speed of drying, it was proposed to use high temperature thermal collectors. Hence, we have suggested further to go for compound solar collectors. The advantage of using compound solar collectors, it doesn't require any tracking. It is capable of producing hot fluid at about 250 degrees centigrade. Thereby, in addition to the existing evacuated tube collectors, compound solar collectors have been added. So they are concentrated collectors which could collect sunlight and concentrate onto absorber tube. Thereby, this can operate at higher temperature. So this fluid will special thermic fluid which can withstand up to 300 degrees centigrade. So this is additionally added so that the air can be heated to an higher temperature of about 160 degrees centigrade. In this video, you could see the evacuated tube collectors behind, and you can also see the conventional power plants at the backdrop, and these are the compound solar collectors recently installed, which is using thermic fluid so that you can get a high temperature working atmosphere. Then this thermic fluid is used for heating the air in order to get about 160-180 degrees centigrade. Then this hot air is used for drying in the rotary drive. Conference room.
Yes.
In fact, you could also see the lignite briquetting machine, which can convert the dried material into briquettes. So there is a briquetting machine which can convert this dried material, and it is blended with after drying, we are blending that with suitable binder material. Then it is briquetted into briquette form. So the powdery lignite is converted into solid briquette so that can be transported over a long distance without any difficulty. The hot air that is coming out of dry air is used for operating an adsorption chiller system to get a chilling effect of about 10 kilowatt capacity. The chilling effect created out of this adsorption chiller is used for cooling the space of room of about 300 square feet area, or alternatively, this can also be used for cooling the hot air coming out of the dryer to condense the moisture in the dryer, so that the moisture which is otherwise get wasted could be condensed and charged back into the ground. This is a close view of your compound collector, thermal storage tank, adsorption chiller. So it is a pilot plant designed and installed by Institute for Energy Studies for Center for Applied Research and Development, and it is implemented by Urja Energy Solutions, and it is meant for drying lignite from 50% moisture to about 15 to 20% moisture, and this plant can also convert this powdery lignite into briquettes. The moment it is converted to briquette, and can be easily transported. And another application, or popular application for using solar energy, is photovoltaic panels. Let's understand, photovoltaic deals with conversion of sunlight into electricity. It is quite possible with the help of solar cells. Solar cells are basically semiconductor material which can convert sunlight energy into sunlight into electricity. Solar cells looks like this, and they are generally made 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter size, and these cells are provided with connectors to get connected with other cells as well. When we connect sufficient number of cells, then we make a module. Module is capable of producing record amount of energy for individual applications. Single module is enough for charging solar lantern. When large amount of power is required, these modules are arranged in a particular pattern known as array. When still large amount of power is required, large number of arrays are connected together to make a solar field. Basically, a solar cell is a PN junction in order to convert photonic energy of sun into electricity. When photovoltaic arrays are exposed to sunlight, they produce DC electricity. Yes, charge controller receives this energy and it manages the energy either to charge the battery or to meet the loads of alternating current type. The energy generated by solar cell is of DC type. When there are DC applications, they can be directly used. When there are AC applications, you basically require an inverter to convert them and then use it into AC loads. This energy is available only during the presence of sunlight. If this energy is required to be used even during the absence of sun, then we need a battery for storing them. In fact, the popular application of solar energy for domestic applications have become popular in 60s and 70s. Now these systems are popularly used in many of the countries. The roof of the houses can be used for mounting solar panels for converting sunlight into electricity. When there is a need for domestic use, it can be used for domestic application. When there is no need in the domestic application, it can be exported to grid. Thereby, we can also get revenue out of it. So the roof of any building can be covered with solar panels to convert sunlight into electricity, either for our own consumption. When there is no need for our own consumption, it can be exported to grid. A solar PV field looks like this. They are modular in nature. We can keep on adding more and more panels so that its capacity can be increased. Then relatively more quantity of energy can be generated either for our own requirement or it can be exported to grid for other uses. When the application is remotely located, it is the most convenient method of energy generation for our local applications. When the application is very remotely located, extending a grid up to that point will be expensive. Thereby, it becomes economically viable and becomes cheaper. When grid lines are to be extended through hills and places with the possibility for landslide, instead of going for extended grid lines, one can go for large-scale solar field or solar field of required size for captive applications or standalone applications. In fact, concentrating solar technologies are another application to generate green energy in such a way that electricity could be generated similar to the way that we have been generating electricity from fossil fuels. So we have seen low temperature applications could be made from solar flat plate collectors. Medium temperature applications can be made from parabolic trough and Fresnel collectors. High temperature applications can be conveniently made from solar central towers or parabolic dish collectors. So parabolic concentrating collectors comes in different form. It could be of either parabolic collector or Fresnel collectors or dish collectors or heliostats type. So in the case of parabolic collectors, there is an absorber tube mounted at the focal point. The working fluid moves through the absorber tube and it collects the concentrated sunlight, thereby it becomes hot enough for required application. You could see the cross section of the parabolic collector. At the focal point, absorber tube is mounted. So this enlarged view shows the location of receiver tube, also known as absorber tube. The collector receives the sunlight. The received sunlight is focused on the receiver tube so that medium temperature or high temperature working fluid is generated. A real parabolic collector looks like this. You could see the reflectors which are arranged in a parabolic shape. The reflectors could be either high quality mirrors or it could be a polished metal sheet. You could see an absorber tube mounted at the focal point. So the absorber tube is visible here. The reflectors are reflectors arranged in parabolic shape could be seen here. And these are the holders for holding the absorber tube. In the case of parabolic collector, the whole collector is tracked or moved in order to track the sun from morning to evening in such a way that the sunlight is properly received and focused on the receiver tube. In the case of Fresnel collectors, the absorber tube is kept stationary and Fresnel collectors are continuously tracked in such a way that they are tracking the sunlight to focus the sunlight onto the receiver tube. Dish-based solar collectors, what they called solar dishes, can also be used for getting even still higher concentration and generating thermal or electrical energy. Nowadays, Stirling engines are available for direct operation. Thereby, a Stirling engine mounted at the focal point of a dish collector can generate electricity for our day-to-day applications. These are your Fresnel collectors. And it can generate about 400 degrees centigrade working fluid. It is of line focusing type. And depending upon the capacity, we can keep on extending its modular nature. It is a dish collector. At the focal point of which you could see, there is a receiver for receiving the sunlight for producing high temperature working fluid. Different form of dish collectors. They are all suitable for medium temperature applications. For high temperature applications, we always go for heliostat-based solar collectors. Large number of solar reflectors are mounted on the ground in such a way that sunlight is received and reflected onto the tower. The tower contains the working fluid for receiving the sunlight and hence it gets heated up. Most of the time it is a molten salt which can withstand even 1000 degrees centigrade or more than that. So this is capable of receiving this heat And then this thermal energy can be transferred to a working medium like water. So this water becomes a steam, and then it goes to a steam drum. Through the steam drum, it is separated to a steam turbine. The turbine converts the thermal energy of the steam into mechanical energy. Then this mechanical energy is converted to electricity through our conventional Rankine cycle. This is condensed back into liquid, and then this liquid is transported back by picking up the heat again and repeating the cycle. This kind of system can be designed such that there is enough amount of material for storing energy even for night application. So these kind of power plants can operate 24 hours a day like our conventional power plant without any interruption, even in the absence of sunlight. A real heliostat based central tower technology looks like this. Many acres of land are used for positioning heliostats, which can collect sunlight and keep reflecting onto the receiver tower continuously throughout the day. The tower will contain working fluid for receiving this energy and storing the energy as well. That stored energy is collected by passing through a usable working medium, and that working medium could be passed through either gas turbine or steam turbine. When it is passed through steam turbine, and it will be operating on Rankine cycle. It is passed through gas turbine, it operates on Brayton cycle, and then generates mechanical energy and electrical energy as usual. Quite interesting fact is that this kind of power plant doesn't require any fuel, and there are absolutely no noise other than a minimal noise created by tracking of this heliostats. Absolutely, there is no pollution. This kind of power plants can operate from 20 years to 50 years with very minimal maintenance without creating any pollution. So it is very viable to install such power plants to generate electricity for our mankind. Instead of going for coal-based power plants, which starts its environmental impact right from the day of installation, even before its operation. Mining of fossil fuels requires a lot of land. The land gets disturbed. Then when the fuel is mined, you require vast land for processing that. Then when the fuel is utilized, the extent of pollution created by such power plants are highly abnormal. The overall consequences of such power plants becomes highly unsustainable. Although it is not possible for us to replace the existing fossil power plants immediately, consistent plans are required to implement such environmental power plants, and we must have a timeline to stop the current way of power generation and go for this kind of sustainable power generation, so that power can be generated from green energy resources as well as it can lead to sustainable environment in future. This is a simplified picture where it shows the central receiver tower. And these are the heliostats mounted on the ground, which receives sunlights and reflects them on the receiver. These heliostats are continuously operated to follow the sun, meaning they have a tracking capability, and hence you can have a high temperature working fluid. And people have established, or technology has been developed, to even generate a working fluid at about 2000 degrees centigrade with the help of this technology. It is another power plant where you could see the heliostats being arranged in pattern. They reflect solar energy on the tower, and the working fluid of about 1500 to 2000 degrees centigrade can be generated. It could be stored even for a big time, even when there is no sun for quite some time or quite few days. The energy stored could be used for operating thermal power plants. These kind of power plants have large initial investment It is a major limitation. However, if you take the overall life of this power plant and the minimal cost of maintenance, then the economics becomes highly viable. The environmental benefits from these power plants is phenomenally high, thereby one should not mind about the large initial investment. So governments and NGOs and interested people should promote this kind of power plants for future applications. It is another close-up view of aerial close-up view of such a power plant, which could be a solution for our future instead of using oil-based, gas-based power plants, coal-based power plants, and lignite-based power plants. These kind of power plants could be a viable solution for our sustainable future. So it shows a schematic diagram where these power plants could be used for generating electricity for transporting, which you have already seen. So there are different kind of collectors available for concentrating applications, based on which you can use it for different purposes. Tailoring a particular collector with an application or identifying a suitable solar system for a record application is itself an art other than a technology. So all those who design renewable energy systems should not stop themselves being a technocrat. They should also know a kind of aesthetic and artistic view, for a simple reason that they are all integrated many times with domestic applications. Thereby, you should be properly integrated with the existing system. Thereby, enough amount of training should be imparted to the people in order to design suitable system for a given application. And they also require maintenance, also they are very minimal. If that minimal maintenance is not provided, they become a big failure over a period of time. Hence, you should be very clearly followed. And another important source of energy which could be used for our day-to-day application is wind energy. We all know the moving air from one place to another place is said to be a wind. And India also takes a pride in being one of the major wind energy generators. And Tamil Nadu and Gujarat are leading in India. And we take a pleasure and pride in generating good amount of wind energy for our day-to-day applications. Basically, it is an aerodynamic system which is capable of converting kinetic energy of wind into mechanical energy. So there are different kinds of wind energy systems. Basically, any wind energy system is likely to have rotor, gearbox, tower, foundation, controls, and generators. The one what we see in the figure is an horizontal axis windmill. So the tower can be as high as 100 feet to 200 feet. And so the wind blades are mounted on a horizontal axis hub. The flow of wind results in rotation of blade. As we all know, when air passes through an aerodynamic structure, it generates lift and drag. The lift and drag forces are responsible for the rotation of the rotor. The rotor, rotating rotor, has mechanical energy. This mechanical energy is converted to electrical energy and transported to grid. We have number of power plants in different parts of Tamil Nadu, like Kayata, Edayar Palayam, Rameshwaram, Nettu, and Sengottai, Muppandal, Aralvai Mali, Udaimalapet, Palladam. And as we said earlier, the moving wind with kinetic energy actuates the actuator, what is known as the rotor, provided with aerodynamic blades, which is capable of converting this wind energy into electrical energy. This technology is also available for few decades. Thereby, the components have been optimized. Now, wind energy systems are available in different parts of the world. Readily they are available, and we have offshore wind energy system, onshore wind energy system. When the space available is limited, we can even install wind energy systems in the shore or in the ocean, and we can convert the energy. So those countries who have limited space, like Singapore, Malaysia, they can go for installing such kind of power plants even in ocean or nearby sea, and energy can be generated for their own applications. Although there are many varieties, among them the most popular ones are horizontal axis wind machines and vertical axis wind machines, and depending upon the power requirement, one can go for different types of wind energy system. Horizontal axis wind machines are highly popular for large scale power generation. Earlier they were in kilowatt capacity, now they are available even in megawatt capacity. A single horizontal axis wind machine is available for about 9 to 10 megawatt, and they can generate quite good amount of energy required for industrial applications. Those industries which are located in a wind prone area but in a remote area, they don't have to depend on conventional electrical supply. They can install their own wind machine and then produce electricity required for them. Vertical axis wind machines will have a rotor which rotates with the vertical shaft, and we can place the gearbox and generator at the ground. That's a major advantage of them. However, they have a limited capacity, and we cannot go for large scale power generation with the help of these kind of systems. So the control systems, monitoring systems and safety systems, a good amount of research has gone into that. Now, wind systems with relatively higher efficiency and high safety are readily available. There are companies like Vestas, Suzlon, you know, in India, supplying these kind of machines. So whenever we require energy, particularly in remote areas and then wind-prone areas, one can go for installing such kind of systems in order to ensure sustainable future. So a wind farm looks like this. When large amount of power is required, more than one windmill is placed one after another. When they are all placed, there are certain rules that to maintain a proper gap between them. Otherwise, their optimal performance gets highly affected. So the power generated from the wind depends on the density of the air and hence the height of the tower, a swept area of the blades and velocity of the wind. These are the major parameters to indicate the power density. The available power depends on the power coefficient and the theoretical limiting factor known as Bates limit. And the wind power generation is a well-established technology. Still, depending upon the amount of energy required and wind speed, different configurations of windmills are being researched by academic and industrial establishments. We are very hopeful that different versions of wind machines are likely to be introduced in recent future as well. However, now the systems available are quite suitable for small scale application to high scale applications. So depending upon our requirement, one should understand how these machines have to be identified and used in terms of efficiency and in terms of suitability, in terms of easiness to construct, in terms of cost. One can choose suitable system for various applications. So whenever you go for a wind farm, a large number of wind machines are arranged in a particular pattern. So good amount of research is being done to decide what should be the gap between one machine behind and another machine, as well as the gap between one machine and the machine adjacent to that. High speed computational tools are available now. Hence, even our center does a lot of simulation studies to understand the effect of the wave created by one machine on the other, thereby identifying a suitable pattern for that. It is needless to say that if you put only few machines, leaving large amount of gap, the land gets wasted, because each machine requires about 5 acres of land. Instead, if you put machines closer to each other, then operation of one machine affects the operation of another machine. Thereby, optimal utilization of the machine becomes highly questionable and unavailable. Thereby, good amount of study must be conducted, and the high performance computing tools like supercomputers, the availability of such supercomputers is highly useful nowadays to understand the operation of them, so that we can use them in a proper form. So when we go for selecting wind sites, one should understand the grid availability for transporting this energy if there is a need for exporting. We should also understand the accessibility for commissioning and the types of the terrain for civil work and the preparation, and the other favorable environmental conditions should be taken into account for identifying the suitable sites. A good amount of research has gone in understanding the need of each parameters. One can very confidently go for installing such system for our day-to-day applications. When we come to this kind of green energy systems, each energy system has its own typical advantage. They may have certain limitations. When certain limitation becomes a big factor of consideration for us, we can go for hybrid systems, so that we can make use of the best of more than one system. One can think of even solar wind hybrid system, so that the best of both of them can be utilized. Or one can think of going for solar biomass hybrid system, or solar wind biomass hybrid system. As we all know, solar system could be used only during daytime if there is no any storage. Wind system can be used only when there is seasonal wind is available. Instead, if you go for a biomass system, it can be used for any time. So they could be coupled together in order to have a hybrid system, to have a beautiful overall grid system. Thereby, a good amount of training is required for designing such kind of systems. And our center is specializing on that. There are number of institutions doing similar work all over India. So we people should get this kind of special capability so that these green energy systems could be put into a better use. We have seen major energy systems that could be used for our green energy applications, and we also understood some of the facts about how to manage about them. Let's understand that our sustainable future can be established only by green energy sources and green technology. And we should think of transforming our energy generation system as early as possible into green energy systems. And our center is helping industries in integrating green energy system with the existing fossil fuel system as a first phase. It is also proposed to work further with industries to identify various areas where the existing conventional systems can be replaced with green energy systems as second phase. Probably later, we have to use green energy system as a replacement for existing conventional systems. So this could be done only in phases. It requires manpower and it requires, you know, our experience. In that way, our institute and, you know, university is interacting with many industries in implementing this, and I'm very happy to know that Chennai Institute of Technology is also is largely interested in associating with such activities, and you'll be happy to do that. This kind of technologies require sustained effort to implement and to improve and modernize. There might be few limitations depending upon the application and locality, and good amount of research should be done to overcome such difficulties, and we should work together to do so. These green energy technologies are relatively costly, particularly the initial investment is considerably high. However, if you look at the levelized cost over the long period of their life, it becomes highly nominal. So it is worth implementing due to their inherent advantages. So understanding of the nature of these green energy technologies and their applications would help all of us to think of alternative solutions to the existing challenges of industries, particularly keeping our environment in mind. So if we all long for sustainable future, pollution-free environment, we have no option other than adapting ourselves to green energy solutions, and we are happy that we can offer such solutions and any help required in this regard, either in terms of design implementation, you can approach us. I have shown already we are in the process of implementing large-scale solutions with industries like NLC India Limited, and we will be happy to extend such help. And I am thankful to the organizer for this opportunity, and I thank all the viewers. And you can send your comments. If there are any short questions, I can answer you as well. Otherwise, you can, you know, send your queries to my email. I can answer you, and we will be very happy to associate with any future initiatives and programs for green energy implementation. Thank you. Thank you, Anita.
Thank you so much, sir, for sharing. We got a very good knowledge on green energy management. There are a few questions asked by our participants.
Please, go ahead.
First question is asked, why we cannot recommend the implementation of solar energy systems in all government offices? How much energy we can save as compared to nominal?
In fact, this program has already is on. All government offices have been requested to install solar photovoltaic systems for their own usage. An agency called Energy Efficiency Services Limited, it is a joint venture of Power Ministry and Energy Efficiency Ministry, has been identified to implement this. Very soon, you will see all the government offices having solar power plants generating their own energy and using for themselves, and they will not use conventional electricity. This was finalized in the beginning of this year. Already circulars have been issued to all government offices, including Anna University. In fact, we have identified all the rooftops, and we are in the process of designing and installing such systems. So this process has already started. Tamil Nadu Energy Development Agency is in charge of implementing this. Already government came with an idea of insisting on all energy, I mean education institutions, to produce at least 6% of their energy from solar energy. There were certain limitations because of the representations made by education institutions. They have been given certain time, so days are not far away for us to see solar systems on all government offices. Very soon we will see them.
Sir, I am happy to say that our management has installed all the roofs. More than 1.65 crore invested around 300 kilowatts energy, solar energy panel in our institute, sir.
Congratulations, sir. In fact, it is not only in terms of environmental benefits, even in terms of financial benefit, it is really beneficial for all of us. So whenever there is, you know, enough amount of capital available, we should invest in installing such system so that, you know, the demand on power becomes less and we become self-reliant. I congratulate you on this attempt.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Patel Rahul Kumar. What is decentralized system?
Well, actually, like as of now, the present day of energy generation and consumption is called as centralized power generation. For example, we have power plants located in Chennai. You generate electricity. You transport this electricity over thousands of kilometers for different parts of state. For example, electricity is generated in North Madras thermal power plant and transported to Kanyakumari over 900 kilometers. First of all, it requires a huge infrastructure in terms of grid. One has to put electrical poles, electrical wires. Then you need large manpower for maintaining this in terms of electrical engineers, helpers, and so on. Third one, during transport of this energy, about 20% of energy is lost in transmission. leave alone energy theft on the way. In international scale, about 10% is in transmission loss, but in India, the transmission loss is about 22%. Instead, if the energy is generated in each district and consumed there itself, there is no need for such big infrastructure for distribution. There is no need for any loss of energy during transmission. In fact, biomass cannot be transported over a long distance for power generation. Whatever is available in the localized area should be collected and utilized. Thereby, instead of putting a large power plant in a single place and transporting this energy over a long distance, putting medium scale power plant or small scale power plant in localized area, generating energy and using it in their own locality is said to be decentralized energy applications. Of course, each and everyone must have a skill and ability to install, manage and operate. And in fact, now everybody operates their cell phone. They're so friendly. Everybody operates their own domestic applications. So now the power plants are made so compact, so modular and so nice, and people could be trained themselves to operate them. In such case, each district will have their own power plant. Each taluk will have their own power plant. They'll be trained how to collect their own resource material, how to convert them into energy and use them. If those days are, you know, going to be a reality, then it will become very, very easier for us to use locally available material and generating energy for ourselves. So such a kind of medium scale or small scale power plants kept in their own locality for their energy generation and usage is what is meant by decentralized power generation.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Siva Subramaniam. Most of the industries are running with fluctuating load. Is both biomass gasification and solar thermal technologies are applicable these kind of loads?
In fact, when the load becomes varying, first thing, whether it is solar or biomass, they are modular in nature. For example, if I need 1 megawatt power, I can go for 4 units of 250 kilowatt. 4 into 250 kilowatt becomes 1000 kilowatt, becomes 1 megawatt. If I descend it so, either I can operate 1 unit or 4 units. If I operate 1 unit, I'll get 250 kilowatt, that is 1/4 of the load. If I operate all the 4 units, I'll get 100% load. Similarly, when you come to solar also, they can be installed in modules. Thereby, these kind of solar systems and biomass systems are more suitable for park load operation than conventional power plants. When you come to conventional power plants, now the power plants, for example, now the thermal power plant is popularly, the capacity is 800 megawatt. If you use 800 megawatt power plant, and if you use that 800 megawatt power plant only to generate 200 megawatt, it operates very low efficiency and becomes highly inconvenient to operate, and cost also becomes high. But when it comes to these biomass based power plants and solar power plants, and they can be installed in modular fashion, instead of installing one large unit, install them in multiple units, and depending upon the load fluctuation, you can match your operation with load. It becomes more convenient.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Dr. Gopal.
Yes,
very
please,
less discussed is tidal. We have very long coastal shore, but why the tidal source of energy is less discussed in our country?
In fact, tidals are more uncertain. The ground reality is very harsh. The initial investment required is very, very high. The other power sources, what is available, is relatively cheaper. That is the reason these kind of energy sources are still under only research and development case, and they are unable to compete with existing energy. I would like to recall a fact that the energy generated from solar was costing about 20 rupees per unit during 70s and 80s. Thereby, solar power generation was not popular. But now, electricity generated from solar is cheaper than electricity generated from coal and oil. Thereby, you could see energy generated from solar is becoming popular. It has become popular just because we have identified alternative materials for solar cells. so that it becomes cheaper. Not only that, we are manufacturing in large scale mass production, thereby it becomes cheaper. Although we have a long cost, the initial investment what is required for establishing either tidal based or wave based power plants are phenomenally high nowadays. Thereby the energy generated from them cannot be a viable energy, just because they are very costly and they cannot compete with energy generated from either coal or oil or from sun, that is solar energy. Thereby days have to go forward to identify alternative technologies, or if I identify any technology which doesn't require large scale investment in the beginning to install, then we can think of such kind of sources. I don't see any good days in future, in the recent future, for a simple reason that the energy intensity is also very, very low. The similar technology is a geothermal technology. There's a large amount of energy is available, but we don't have any good technology to convert that into a viable power output. Thereby, geothermal technology and the wave-based technologies and tidal-based technologies are not likely to be popular in the recent future. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. One more question for Shanti. Why we are not able to save more wind energy by using a battery? What is the real problem?
In fact, for any energy, storage is not a solution. The moment energy is generated, and it should be used as quickly as possible. And moreover, if you store it as an energy in battery, it is more dangerous. You know very well, batteries are highly dangerous to environment. Thereby, I won't recommend any energy storage in battery at all, first of all. And if at all, to be stored in battery, we all know very well, we don't have any battery which will last for more than 2-3 years. Wind machine itself will last for 25 to 50 years, but for every 3 years or every second year, I have to keep changing batteries. That's not a good solution. Instead, there are alternative ways of storing this energy, like the pumped water storage and so on. When large amount of wind energy is available, use that water for pumping water from low level to high level. Then use that potential energy of water to drive turbine to generate electricity. They are far better than storing energy with the help of the battery. Thereby, we can think of other alternative way of storing energy. First of all, energy storage is not preferable. Make it as an hybrid system. If there is a limited option, then you can go for storing energy in a much better way than batteries. That's my solution and answer.
Thank you, sir. One last question. Why most of the solar park in India are flat plate base, which consumes more space when we have other types?
When it comes to thermal applications, flat plate collectors, that's what I understand from your question, because quite naturally for all electrical application use only flat solar collectors. Nowadays, even concentrated PV collectors have come. But unfortunately, even flat solar collectors we are importing from other countries for a simple reason, they are available in relatively cheaper rate. The technology is not perfected in India, and we don't have enough manpower, skilled manpower to operate them. Now, probably, Corona has shown a way for all of us to be self-dependent. And we all have to invest large in research and development and develop our own technologies. The moment we understand our own strength, certainly we'll go for it. And I look forward to those good days. And quite, hopefully, probably within a decade, we'll see such systems in India as well now. Let's look for them.
Thank you, sir, for answering patiently for all the questions.
Pleasure is mine.
Your lecture or your speech is very much useful, and I think you can also see that the chat box participants are saying very much informative session, useful session. So we are also thanked from Chennai Institute of Technology, also from chairman. Your service or your help to our institute is very much useful, and I thank you once again for this wonderful lecture, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. My special thanks to all the viewers and you know, the girl who has been very interestingly coordinating this. And my thanks to your chairman for arranging this kind of lectures for the benefit of all others. And personally, I'll be very happy to help you, because I am very inclined to developing new technologies and spreading these technologies for industrial applications. As a dean of College of Engineering, Guindy, I have much more higher responsibility to comply with your requirements of any help in future. Please feel free to contact us at any time, and we'll be happy to extend any possible help in every possible form in future collaboration. Okay, thank you. Thank you so much once again. Thank you, Honorable. Thank you.
Dear participants, the afternoon session will be at 1:30. So kindly join at 1:20. Please kindly join at 1:20. Okay. Thank you very much.